Welcome back to the 16th part of Debugging Scale, where we discuss the debugging tricks that we've been keeping to ourselves for all these years. Up until now, we discussed general strategies when dealing with issues. In this video, I want to focus on some useful tips for debugging. These are several core techniques that will help us improve our productivity while debugging. The term rubber ducking originates with a developer who supposedly brought with him a rubber duck to talk to when facing an issue. This illustrates a common developer observation. When we consult a colleague, we often find the problem before the person we're talking to says a word. Verbalizing the problem often forces us to pay attention to nuance that we sometimes gloss over. This works even when talking to an inanimate object, and works even when running this exercise in your head, although it's not as effective for some. The script for duck conversation should usually follow the line of describe the problem. Start with, here's the problem, or something similar. This is often the point where you might notice something wrong with the problem description. Point out your theory. For instance, this is the area that might be the source of the problem. Explain the reasoning, why you think this area can be the reason. Explain why other areas of the code can't be the cause of the problem. This is an important step because we often notice a flaw in our reasoning here. Finally, explain how you're verifying each of the previous statements one by one. During that explanation, the verification process might reveal a flaw in your logic. Moving the goalposts is awful when someone does that to you. It's a great way to attack a bug, though. Bugs usually start with a user-level description, which is usually very symptomatic. For instance, wrong value for a UI element. As we work on the bug, we might find that this results from the backend that's wrong. We can change the bug and redefine it, ideally on the issue tracker too. So our goal and scope of code is narrower. This is an iterative process of honing in on the bug, which we normally do intuitively, but we rarely go to the trouble of redefining the bug. This is an important mental exercise and also an important team communication tool. When you mention this in the dailies, it might trigger recognition in a team member and help lead to the correct fix. Every system has at least two directions. I discussed this in the tongs section before, but it bears repeating. If you're stuck, flip the direction and try from a different angle. There are many angles to approach any bug and many different ways and ideas to debug something unique. Unlike pair programming, which can be a lengthy process, just 5 minutes with a teammate can help change your outlook on an issue and expose you to a completely different thought process. Hard to reproduce bugs are terribly frustrating when you're faced with such a situation. Try external limiting factors that break your environment that might trigger the bug more readily. Good examples for such disruptions would be systems like network throttling, slow motion mode, etc. I often debug client code when connected to a tethered phone. This both removes me from the company's internal network, which is a major disruption. A common bug is inadvertently relying on company network topology. It also slows my connection significantly, which might impact the application. This can produce different error messages reproduce an issue more consistently, fail to reproduce it entirely, or some other behavior, all of which are crucial clues in the bug hunting process. Similarly to the previous point, switching the OS entirely can sometimes expose interesting information about a hard to track bug. At Sun, we used to have Spark and Windows machines connected to a KVM. We'd constantly toggle between the two and often found weird issues when moving back and forth. Switching the OS, browser, JVM, compiler, etc. can have a significant impact. The tooling of a specific environment might also provide a different angle. I prefer working with Firefox and its developer tooling when debugging front-end issues. Occasionally, I'll look at the problem in Chrome DevTools to get a different perspective, where I might notice something I missed in Firefox. All development environments have special debugging extensions and tools we can use to get more information, insight, and also perform disruptive investigations. Web development tools in the browser include deep inspection capabilities. Phones have developer modes that you can activate to leverage some amazing tooling. Server APIs like Spring include aspects for logging automatically on every method, entry or exit, actuator, and so many other tools. I discuss some of the low-level tools like JMX in the next module. We can use these tools both as an investigative prong or as a tool to impact the application as a disrupting mechanism. But in order to do that, we need to be deeply familiar with the environment we're running in and with the vendor tools for it. For many developers, sleep is the best debugging tools as they wake up with the solution. I agree with one personal caveat. I'm a terrible sleeper. When I have a bug, I can't sleep. I need to try everything first. Otherwise, I lie in bed frustrated. But I can get up and walk away from the computer and drink a cup of coffee, have a conversation with someone about something else. Disconnecting and then coming back to the problem puts us in a fresh mindset to tackle the problem. It's important not to jump right back into the place you were before when doing that. Try to forget everything and approach the problem fresh. To notice the things you missed the first time around. I find that most frustrating problems result from something small I missed when I rushed when working on this problem initially. Debugging should be fun and challenging. And if it isn't, you should find a way to enjoy this puzzle treasure hunt. I'm very competitive. As a result, I'm not a fan of most puzzles and games because, like many, I don't enjoy losing. Debugging is a game I love because I'm good at it. I still enjoy it when I'm terrible at it, though. We all sometimes. Because, like in any game, we have our good and bad days. If you can't find the pleasure in debugging, try debugging code that isn't yours. Try debugging things that aren't a part of your job. Do you enjoy doing that? We often conflate stress about having a bug or work stress related to the project, since the debugging process is so amorphous, it can drag on. This makes us feel stupid, incompetent, and can promote imposter syndrome. These are universal feelings that are shared by experienced and fresh developers alike. I would suggest isolating whether these are job-related tensions that are causing this frustration, or if they're related to personal embarrassment. If the latter, I suggest sitting down with the most senior developer you know and tell that person about your dumbest bug, I'm confident that they'll share a similar story. If not, feel free to send me your dumbest bugs. I spent a couple of days jacking a less than operator facing in the wrong way. A NASA engineer confused metric and imperial measurements, costing them $327 million because of that mistake. I'm sure the engineers or the code reviewers are some of the smartest people out there. If they can have such a terrible outcome, then nothing you can do can rival it. If you feel that this is all due to work-related stress, I suggest taking time to talk to your manager about the stress. It's often counterproductive and could slow you down as you rush to debug, which is something that should be a more creative process. I suggest talking to a senior mentor and seeking help in such cases. Some developers have an issue with confrontation. A senior friend can help in such situations. Finally, the most important part is to use the debugging checklist. A checklist is one of the most important tools for process automation. As part of my debugging process, I follow the rules illustrated here and narrow them down based on the list. The big ticket items on the list are: make the simplest assumption you can about the bug. Not a grand assumption as it's caused by X, but rather a small assumption like variable Y should have this value at this time. Now, just start validating assumptions. Use a debugger or any tool at your disposal to validate that the assumption is indeed correct. Every time an assumption doesn't pan out, you need to get an explanation. By following this process and acknowledging the assumptions I've made, I can slowly hunt down a bug. The important part of this is keeping track of the assumptions made and implied. That's where we often fail when a bug gets out of hand. We assume things might not always be true. List your assumptions. Some developers find that using pen and paper helps them visualize this. Then review them over and over as you slowly narrow down on the problematic area. I hope you find these tips useful and can find joy in your debugging sessions. Don't stress over debugging and don't let it take you down. Look at it like a cool puzzle tailored just for you. The next video will move us to the third module, where we will start discussing auxiliary tools, starting with Dtrace. If you have any questions, please use the Slack channel to ask them. Thank you.